copyrighted program created by the Rio Grande Oil Company.
Tucson police calling all cars, attention all cars. Attention all Pima County Sheriff's cars, broadcast 111. Be on the lookout for Model D Ford Roadster. License D like Victor 625. D like Victor 625. Is believed to have been used as a getaway car in the murder of Frank Zell. That's all.
Tanks of Rio Grande cracked gasoline. Check my oil, please.
Yes, sir.
Well, I see they've turned all your Rio Grande dealers into gasoline G-men now.
Yes, we're all G-men since we got this new Rio Grande G-gas. And we're all on the hunt for public enemy number 101.
Public enemy number 101? What does that mean?
Well, there's a lot of cheaply made cut-price bootleg gasolines that can't equal the United States government specification number VBG-101. We call such bootleg gasoline public enemy number 101. Because the government says it isn't safe for use.
I suppose your new G-Gas is the lowest price gasoline it's safe to buy, huh?
You've got to give Rio Grande credit for being the first to bring out a low-price gasoline that's guaranteed to exceed United States government specifications for quality in every point.
You think it's a better buy than cracked gasoline?
I'd just as soon pay a little less, you know.
No, sir. Honestly, it isn't.
Rio Grande developed G-Gas to fight the bootleggers in the oil industry who are selling sub-quality gasoline at low prices. G-Gas sets a new standard of quality in the low-price market. And for those who want the cheapest gasoline, G-Gas is the only safe buy. But it doesn't compare with Rio Grande's cracked gasoline. They make cracks to exceed emergency specifications. And that's why it's used by more police and emergency cars than any other brand. You get 100% engine efficiency with cracked gasoline. You get tetraethyl. You get more power, speed, liveliness, greater mileage. And Rio Grande Cracks is the only gasoline made that gives you police car performance.
And now it is our pleasure to present Chief of Police T.A. Wallard of Tucson, Arizona. Chief Wallard.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Our policing problems in Tucson, Arizona are somewhat different from those in larger metropolitan centers. Tucson is surrounded not by populous suburbs, but by deserts and mountains. A criminal can easily escape to these trackless wastes, where, if he is at all cunning, he may elude capture for days, sometimes for months. So, in law enforcement in Tucson, you have an interesting example of the cooperation possible between city and county authorities. Sheriff Belden of Pima County and his men, and I and my men, are called upon to preserve law and order over the entire county, an area of more than 11,000 square miles. Constantly, in our work, we of the police department have asked the assistance of the sheriff's office, or, as in the case of the dramatization you are about to hear, the sheriff's office is required to ask our cooperation. As a matter of fact, a great number of men under my command on the police force are also commissioned as deputy sheriff. In addition, our geographical position, so close to the Mexican border, also brings in the federal authorities on the border patrol, who've always worked closely with us. You can readily see that with city, county, and federal law enforcement agencies working in such a tightly interlocking system, the lawbreaker in Tucson is being quickly convinced that he can't get away with it. The state penitentiary of Florence has quite a few steady boarders who have learned from Sheriff Belton and me that crime doesn't pay.
The Portalitas Mountains outside Tucson, Arizona, are crowned with gray clouds. Lightning flashes about the crest of Mount Lemmon. The dying sun sends one somber streak of red across the desolate overcast desert, and then soaks to extinction. The Boss, send it with a thunder for around the globe. The ground of heaven, he was burning. And far below, a rickety model T-4 plugged up a sandy hill. The first drop of rain having its best shaped skin. As it reaches the top of the rise,
bushwhack him for his money.
Well, possibly revenge was the motive.
Did Dale have any enemies you know of, Mr. Anderson?
None that I know of. He's a quiet, peaceable fellow. Minded his own business and kept his nose out of other folks. We all thought a lot of him out this way, though none of us knew him very well.
Well, we'll have to check back on him. Glenn?
Yes, sir?
We'll go along with Mr. Anderson here up to Zell's house. Go over the place thoroughly and see what you can dig up.
Yes.
Johnson and I will go down to Kataro and see what we can find out there about him. Meet you back at headquarters as soon as you get through.
Yes, sir. Come on, Mr. Anderson. Mr. Anderson.
Everyone the sheriff questioned assures him that the murder victim was a law-abiding citizen, and no one knows of any grudge against him. The sheriff has returned to headquarters when Deputy Hunter arrives.
Well, Glenn, did you find any guns out there, Zell Jack?
No, no guns. Lots of books around the place, though, on public speaking, willpower, physical culture, and that sort of thing. And I found this scrapbook. Tells a lot about the guy. See? Here's a clipping about him when he was fighting under the name of Jack Kelly. According to this, Jack Kearns was his manager. And then over here is his enlistment papers from the Army. Drawn up in 1917 with the 33rd Field Artillery. Here you can see, here. He served several hitches, and every discharge is marked honorable or excellent.
Yes, that's all very well, but I'm interested in guns. You say you didn't find any guns?
No.
There were supposed to be three guns in that cabin.
I went over the place from top to bottom, and I didn't find a single one. I found a shotgun rammer and some ammunition for a .22.
Yes, according to Zell's neighbor, he owned a .32-20 carbine, and that's the type of gun he was killed with. I believe, since you found no guns at Zell's cabin, that he was murdered with his own gun by someone who had stolen it from the shack during his absence.
Why would they lay him in the desert? Why not kill him at home?
That's me. The killer probably wanted to be sure to escape detection. And he certainly did a good job of that with the rain to help him. Probably over to the coast or down in Mexico by now.
Maybe he didn't try to make his getaway. Maybe he's still right here in Tucson.
I doubt it.
Wouldn't hurt to ask Chief Dyer to give us some help on the city angle.
Okay, I'm willing to try anything. I'll call him right away.
Sheriff Bailey enlists the assistance of Chief Jackie Dyer of the Tucson Police Department. Within 15 minutes, the chief has collected his department head and is issuing orders.
Boys, the sheriff has asked our cooperation on his own murder. He feels that the killer is different. I can't agree with him. I've got a suspicion he's right here in town. I want you to have your men cover the city for Zell's car. It was stolen at the time he was murdered. The car was seen coming toward town last night with a dark-looking fellow driving it. It was a Model T Roadster, license number V625. Now get out and pick it up.
Okay.
Dallas Ford. Wait a minute, I got a special job for you.
Okay.
Dallas, I've got a theory on this, Steve.
Yes?
Yes. In the first place, I think our man is right here in town. Also, I'm sure that he stole all three of Zell's guns. The .32-20 that murdered Zell, a 12-gauge shotgun, and a .22 rifle. Now, sooner or later, he's going to get low on funds if he isn't already
sold. Yeah, and then he'll try and sell the guns, that is.
Exactly. Now, I want you to check all the pawn shops and the second-hand stores and inform the dealers to notify us if any of these guns are offered for sale.
Yes, sir. I'll get on it right away.
And while Detective Ford begins the job of checking the pawn shop, squads of officers comb Tucson for the missing murder car. Early on the morning of August 7th, 36 hours after the murder, officers Charles Eaton and Walker Hyde are cruising down West Simpson Street in the police car as they approach the intersection of Mission Street.
Hey, Charlie. There's a Model T Roadster.
Where?
Standing by that old brick kiln.
Oh, yeah. I see it. Better pull up. Well, come on. This will be the seventh old week we've checked over since we come on duty.
Yeah. Not much use looking at this one. It's been burned up.
Been set on fire, you mean?
What do you mean?
Smell that gasoline?
Yeah.
All around the car. Somebody doused that car with gas and then set fire to it. I wonder why.
That's why.
What?
The license plate. V625. You can still make out the numbers even if the paint is burned away. That's the car that Frank Zell was killed in.
By God, you're right, Walker.
Look, they shipped it before they burned it. But they forgot to remove the plate.
And the windshield's broken.
Yeah, a fat chance of getting trimmed, though. The paint's been blistered. All the upholstery and woodwork burned.
Well, we're collecting a crowd of interested bystanders. Maybe they know something about this.
Let's ask this old Mexican woman. You live around here, lady?
We live over there, across the street.
Whose car is it?
Car.
Who set fire to it?
Car.
Did you see it burning?
No.
She's not going to be any help. I'll try old Uncle Tom here. Hey, Pop, whose car is this? Looks like it was burned, don't it?
It sure does.
When was it burned? How long's it been there?
It was here day afternoon, I think. It was about 6 o'clock in the morning.
I see them burn the car.
You did?
Steve, it was last night.
Who did it?
Those hours. Two men. One is black, one is white.
Sure it wasn't a Mexican?
No, senor. No Mexicano, but not mobile.
If that kid telling the truth, this doesn't make any sense at all.
Well, we better get what's left of the car into headquarters and let Mark Robbins go over it for identification.
But Mark Robbins, famed identification expert of the Tucson Police Department, can find no fingerprints or blood traces on the badly burned automobile. And meanwhile, Detective Dallas Ford, making his weary round of the pawn shops and second-hand stores, drops into a little shop on West Broadway.
Hello, Herman.
Hello, Bailey. How's the policing business?
Oh, it's all right, Herman. How's the money lending racket?
It's terrible. How can I make a living when everyone wants to borrow money and nobody wants to pay it back? Then nobody comes in to buy merchandise? I'm telling you, Dallas, the country's in bad shape.
Yeah, so I've heard.
Yeah, I couldn't sell you some nice first-grade merchandise, could I, Dallas?
No, if I'm after information. I don't want to buy that.
What is it you want to know?
Anybody sold you any guns lately?
No, I ain't bought a gun for 2 weeks.
Well, if anyone comes in and tries to sell you a gun, you let me know.
Tries to sell a gun? Hey, Dallas, there was a fellow in here trying to sell me a gun.
Yes? When was this?
Just his name.
Well, who was it?
A Mexican fella.
What kind of a gun?
I don't know. He didn't have it with him. Just had to sell.
What caliber?
32-20.
32-20? That's the size rifle I'm looking for.
Well, I told him to go bring me in the gun. You know, he must be crazy. I was buying my gun by looking at the sheriff.
Did he say he'd be back?
Well, he said he'd bring the gun around, but maybe he won't. You know, sometimes they never come back.
Well, now, listen, Herman. I want you to let me know if he comes back.
Sure, I'll do that.
Now, you call me at headquarters and then stall the bird until we can get over there. We want to talk to him.
Yes, sure. I'd be glad to if I can.
Well, you've got to.
Reason, how will I stall him?
Any way you can. Bargain with him. Keep him arguing. We won't be long getting here.
Within 3 hours, the excited farm shopkeeper calls headquarters and informs them that the same Mexican's in store. Detective Ford is not at headquarters, so Captain C.B. Wilbank and Officer Philip Villasuda, jumping into a police car, arrive at the pawn shop 5 minutes after the call.
I tell you, I can't give you more than $2.50 for it.
But, senor, consider, it is very valuable. It is worth much more.
To my own grandmother, I could not give you more than $2.50.
Oh, hello, Herman.
Yes, hello, Captain. I had a pretty hard time.
Is this your man?
And now he tries to sell me a box.
What's your name?
My name? Why, who are you?
Police officer.
Police?
Yes. What's your name?
My name is Florentino Ruiz.
Where are you from?
Here, Nick.
Is the fellow who wanted to sell you the rifle, Herman?
He's very soon, man.
I guess we'll have to place you under arrest, Mr. Ruiz.
I have done nothing. Why should you place me under arrest?
They want to ask you some questions about that rifle you've got for sale.
Back Back at headquarters, Valentino Ruiz, Mexican, is questioned by Chief Dyer and Detective Crona.
Very calm, Mr. Price, senor. The senor at the pawn shop is mistaken. I said nothing about a rifle. I was trying to find the value of the watch.
Where did you get the watch?
It belongs to a friend of mine. I am poor, but I am honest. I have done nothing.
You have the watch with you?
See.
Let me see it.
Here you are.
Belongs to a friend of yours, huh?
See.
Would have his jewels you wear, Ruiz.
See.
Pretty large for you, aren't they?
See.
Where'd you get them?
I bought them, Jefe. My feet, they're sore. I like shoes large.
I see. Well, how about that gun?
What gun?
A gun you tried to pawn.
Well, there is a mistake. I did not try to pawn a gun.
Well, we just drop over to your place on McCormick Street and take a look around.
Captain Wilbanks is sent to search Ruiz's room. Now, within half an hour, enthusiastically brings a gun into the office of identification expert, Mark Robbins.
Well, here's the gun that shot Drill, Mark.
How do you know?
It's a .32-20 Winchester, and I found it in Ruiz's room.
That's circumstantial evidence.
Yeah, I know it, but I know, too, that I can count on you to make it material evidence.
Well, we'll see. Let's have the gun. Old model, isn't it?
Yeah.
Set up the test box, will you, Nick?
Yes, sir.
This ought to be the murder weapon. Drill owned the .32-20. He was shot with one. Ruiz tried to pawn one, and we found this one in his room.
All ready,
sir. Okay, we'll see soon enough. Now, just load this baby up. Now, we'll shoot a few rounds into the test box. Now, we'll have a look at these cells. Come on over here to the comparison microscope, Wilbanks.
All right.
Now, we'll place the shell found at the scene of the crime under one side of the microscope, and we'll place one of the shells we just fired under the other side. Yes. Now, just a moment until I line them up. There, Wilbanks. Take a look and tell me what you think.
The two shells have identical firing pin marks.
They also have identical scars on the side from the breech block.
Then Ruiz killed Frank Bell.
I don't know whether Ruiz did, but I'm prepared to testify that this gun did.
Ruiz denies possession of a gun, denies burning Bell's automobile, denies killing Bell, explains the blood stains he searched as rabbit blood. But Chief Dyer remains unimpressed by Ruiz's laconic confusion. Then the detectives running down clue after clue. Finally, on August 8th, 3 days after the death of Frank Zell, Valentino Ruiz is formally charged with his murder. On Wednesday, August 12th, he is given a short preliminary hearing. By his own request, the laconic Mexican acts as his own attorney. One by one, the witnesses damn him by their testimony. A young Mexican roommate of Ruiz
testifies. Valentino, he seemed wearing tan shoes, but last week he come home wearing deep black shoes. No, Valentino did not have gone before that night.
I got the shoes and gone from a man I know. I have forgot his name.
Another friend of Ruiz testifies.
Florentino and me, we worked 3 days last summer digging well for the Americano. I do not know Americano as well.
A chauffeur testifies.
These tan shoes which were found at the scene of the crime, I sold them to the defendant. I remember because I stretched them to accommodate a bunion on his right foot.
You're wrong. You never sold these to me. There are many tan shoes that I make.
These are the shoes Florentino wear before other night.
There are many shoes like that.
Yes, that is Frank Bell's watch. I remember repairing it. My mark is on the inside of the case.
I got it from a friend.
I have sold those black shoes for Mr. Bell.
Man, gave them to me.
gun that murdered Zell.
I don't know you, Bob.
You murdered Zell.
No.
Confess, Roy. You murdered Zell.
No, no, no. I'm innocent. I'm innocent. No, don't let it be. Look, they know
but the testimony in a preliminary trial is sufficient to hold Ruiz for Superior Court without bail. He is sent back to his cell, left completely alone. But the solitude is not unpeople. For 2 days, thoughts tumble through Ruiz's brain, awake or sleeping, voices whisper in the ear.
He comes home wearing these glasses.
That's true. Yes, I have to live for Mr. Zell. Mr. Zell.
Well done. We found it in your room. The gun you used to murder. Murder.
Murder.
You done. What?
But he tried to tell me. Fight upon the gun. A gun. A gun.
A gun you used to murder.
Best of all, these departments report that their operating costs
records, prove Rio Grande Crack to be the most economical gasoline it has ever used. Why don't you get the same gasoline from your Rio Grande dealer and enjoy the greater power, economy, and satisfaction of police car performance in your own car?
Tucson Police calling all cars, attention all cars. Cancellation broadcast 111. Regarding the murder of Frank Zell, this case is now closed. That's all.
Free gifts. Ask your Rio Grande dealer about the new detective outfit that Rio Grande gives free to boys and girls. This is your narrator, Frederick Lindsley, saying good night for the Rio Grande Oil Company.